فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد، إن شاء الله تعالى ننتقل إلى مسألة مهمة. We're going to now move on to a very important matter. We spoke about last lesson توحيد الألوهية, and we spoke that first of all we mentioned the importance of توحيد الألوهية, and then what we did was we mentioned what توحيد الألوهية stands on. We said it stands on two things. The first thing it stands on is معنى الإله. What does إله mean? And which is لا إله إلا الله. What does it mean? And the perception to be correct. لأن الحكم على شيء فرع عن تصوره. For you to place a ruling on something, first of all, you have to have correct perception of it. Then we said the second thing it stands on was what? هو إفراد الله بالعبادة. It's a single Allah in what? In عبادة. And we dealt with that in our last lesson. Inshallah ta'ala, we're now going to speak about what is it that will nullify our Tawheed al-Uluhiyya. May Allah protect us from this. What is it that which can nullify our Tawheed al-Uluhiyya? Okay. As you can see on the board, what's written at the top is Nawaqid Tawheed al-Uluhiyya. Nawaqid Tawheed al-Uluhiyya. And that means the nullifiers of Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, the things that can nullify it. And I said two things that are what can nullify it. The first one is Shirkul Akbar. And the second one is Shirkul Asghar. And we'll speak about each and every one of them, inshaAllah ta'ala. Shirkul Akbar is the first one we're going to start with. Shirkul Asghar, we're going to first, inshaAllah, divide the people's iman into three. أهل السنة والجماعة, if you read books of Iman, like كتاب الإيمان by Ibn Manda رحمه الله, تعظيم قدر الصلاة written by Muhammad Nasr al-Marwazi, كتاب الإيمان by Ibn Taymi has two, he has كتاب الأوسط which is the شرح حديث جبريل. If you read the book written by Abu Ubaid Qasim ibn Salam, he has a book كتاب الإيمان where he speaks about it. الله المستعان على ما تصفون, Ibn Manda I mentioned he has a كتاب الإيمان. If you read the books of Aqidah books, for instance, Kitab Usul I'tiqad Ahli Sunnati wal Jama'ah written by Abu Qasim Hibatullahi Al-Lalaka'i, Al-Hujja Fi Bayan Al-Mahajja written by Abu Qasim Al-Taymi, Kutub Aqaid, Sharh Al-Sunnah, Usul Al-Sunnah books, if you read them, they all speak about what Iman means and the definition of Iman and what it stands on, what are its arkan, what are its usul, what is it Ahli Sunnah unanimously agree upon, and etc. And what are the groups that go against Ahlul Sunnah in the issue of Iman? Shirkul Asghar is an issue that's related to Iman. When it's spoken about, Kufr, Shirk are always spoken about. And Ahlul Sunnah don't forget mentioning it. Shirkul Asghar Akbar, Shirkul Akbar, what it does is that it damages and it directly affects the person's tawheed, aslu tawheed, ama aslu iman. So, if a person comes with shirkul akbar, the asl of your iman will go. Now, what does aslu iman mean? The iman is of these three components. Okay, and all those books I referenced, you'll find them in it. Okay, the asl of the iman is the foundation. If you don't have this, you have no iman anymore. You've left the religion. It's like the human heart. You lose your heart, you're dead. You're not going to live. The asl of the iman is like that. If it gets attacked, you are gone. Shirk, what it does is that it directly attacks the asl of the iman. And so the person leaves the religion of Islam like that. يَخْرُجُ صَاحِبُهُ عَنِ الْمِلَّةِ. The person leaves the religion. كماله الواجب. The person doesn't leave the religion, but what happens? He's on a very, very, very serious situation right now. We're scared for you. We fear disbelief for you. يُخْشَى لَهُ. We're scared for you. And that is like losing a body part. Can you die from it? Yes. Can you live from it? Yes. It's like losing a body part. It's not like your heart. If you lose your arm, you can still live, but you are deficient. And the kamalul wajib is that which your iman is defected. It is in a critical situation, basically. Kamalul mustahab is what? It's like losing your hair. If you become bald, you have no hair. Are you going to die? No. Are you in a critical situation? No. But you lose your beauty, right? And that is what it takes away from you. Kamalul mustahab. These three, as I said, you find it in the books of Ahlul Sunnah I mentioned, and it's also taken directly from the statement of the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam's hadith, the hadith in which Al-Imam al-Bayhaqi, because of it, he wrote a book about it. Hadith Shu'ab al-Iman. The Prophet said, Al-Imanu bid'un wa sab'una shu'ba, a'laha qawlu la ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah is the aslul iman. It's the foundation of your iman. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وإماطة الأذى عن الطريق, which is كمال المستحب, taking harm off the earth. That's كمال المستحب. If you don't do that, you're missing out from the كمال المستحب. And then the كمال الواجب is what? والحياء من الإيمان. And shyness is of إيمان. It's from the كمال الواجب. It's from the كمال الواجب. So أهل السنة categorized it into the three. They took it from the hadith of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Now, I explained what Shirk al-Akbar means. It means, or it is, sorry, anything that attacks Aslul Iman. And Shirk Asghar is anything that attacks Kamalul Wajib. And we'll talk about that, inshallah ta'ala, soon, bi-idhnillahi al-Kareem. Now, but what is the definition? What is the actual definition of Shirk al-Akbar? What's the actual definition for it? The definition is something that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam defined. Our Messenger defined it. So then there's no need for anyone to come and to what? To define it. What did the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam define Shirk al-Akbar as? Based on the hadith, قَدْ سُئِلَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The Messenger was asked, أَيُّ ذَنْبِ أَعْظَمْ. What's the greatest sin? What's the greatest sin? And the Messenger responded by saying, أَنْ تَجْعَلَ لِلَّهِ نِدًّا وَهُوَ خَلَقَكَ. أن تجعل لله ندا وهو خلقك. It is to associate partners with Allah when He created you. It is to associate partners with Allah تبارك وتعالى when He is the one who created you. Pay attention here. Anyone who associates partners with Allah, he has fallen into what? Shirk al-Akbar. Well, that is what Shirk al-Akbar is. So the definition is the first point that we're at. Brothers, pay attention here and I want you to focus. Don't lose your focus here. The first one is, أن تجعل is to make لله ندا وهو خلقك, based on the hadith Sahihain. That the Prophet ﷺ said, it is to associate partners with Allah. It's to make something equal to Allah. Now, we're going to now move on to the second point, which is, give us an example. Give us an example of associating partners with Allah. So the second point here is, what does it mean, an example of associate partners with Allah? This is where it's very important to understand, because وَبِالْمِثَالِ يَتَّضِحُ الْمَقَالِ. Examples, they clarify things for you. Things that have ambiguity on it, it's unclear to you, you don't know what it means. The minute, inshallah ta'ala, we give an example, it will become crystal clear for you, inshallah ta'ala. Associating partners with Allah, it occurs from one of two ways. I want you to know this, inshallah ta'ala. Two things. The first one is dua, ibadah. And the second one is dua, dua mas'ala. Dua ibadatin or dua mas'alatin. What do they both mean? These are the example, inshallah ta'ala. So let me explain it for you. Dua ibadah is every act of worship. Every act of worship. And we already know what a worship is. Ismun jami'u li kulli ma yuhibbuhu Allah wa yarda min al-aqwali wal-a'mali al-zahirati wal-batina. It is everything which Allah is pleased with. It is everything which Allah tabarak wa ta'ala loves. Whether that be an action which is external or internal, or whether it's a speech, it doesn't matter. We spoke about that before. We know what ibadah means. Dua ibadah, it means, because they both came together, what it means is that every single worship that a person does is a dua ibadah. For instance, when I now pray salah, this praying that I am doing, it's a ibadah, but it's a dua. How is it a ibadah? And how is it a dua? Because why are you praying for my beloved brother and sister? The reason why you went and you prayed dhuhr, or fajr, and then dhuhr, and then asr, and then maghrib, and then isha, is because you're asking Allah for jannah. And you're seeking refuge from the hellfire. That's why you're doing that. So every act of ibadah is a dua. You're actually asking through your action for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to take you to Jannah. And through your action, you're seeking refuge from the hellfire. That's why it's called dua ibadah. The same as fasting. Why are you fasting for? Why are you going through this hardship of depriving yourself from food and drinking? It's because you want Jannah through your action. You're asking from Allah, oh Allah, I want Jannah by fasting. Oh Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, protect me from the hellfire. Then your actions in and within itself, this act of worship is a what? You're asking through it, Jannah, and you're seeking refuge from the hellfire from it. So that's why it's called dua ibadah. Can I divert any of those acts for anybody other than Allah? Can I pray to Allah other than Allah? Nope. That's a shirk. Can I fast for anybody other than Allah? Nope. That's shirk. Can I... for example, slaughter for anybody other than Allah? No, that's shirk. Can I make an oath for anybody other than Allah? No, that's shirk. And then those are all dua ibadah. If you divert that for anybody other than, if you give it to anybody other than Allah, if you divert it from Allah and you give it to anybody other than Allah, you have fallen into what? Shirk al-akbar. So the first example, so we're on this point, right? Amthilatuhu, example of it. The first example was dua ibadah. Is that crystal clear with everybody? Does that make sense? Now we're going to swiftly move on to the second point, inshallah ta'ala. The second one is dua mas'ala. What does that mean? What does dua mas'ala actually mean? Dua mas'ala, it actually means and tas'ala, that you ask. Watatluba, or you request. Shay'an, something. You actually are asking for it. You are now asking for it. Pay attention now. This is of two types. Dua mas'ala and dua ibadah. It's of two types. The first one was dua ibadah. My beloved brothers and sisters, did you see? Can you divert it for anybody other than Allah? Are you allowed to divert dua ibadah for anybody other than Allah? Is there any exceptions? There's no exception. All of dua ibadah, you can't divert it for anybody other than Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. As for dua mas'ala, there is permissibility and there's something that's not permissible. So the first one is that which is jaiz, permissible. And there's second one which is غير جائز. Oh, so it's not all prohibited. No, they're not all prohibited. Let's go into it now. Dua mas'ala is the one that's permissible. Not all of them are shirk. Some of them are allowed to be diverted for anybody other than Allah. And there are those which are not allowed to be diverted for anybody other than Allah. The one that's allowed to be diverted for anybody other than Allah, there are conditions that it has to meet. The first condition is what? You have to ask of somebody who is what? Hay, alive. Second, Hayyun Hadir, he has to be present. And the third one is what? He has to be what? He has to be qadir. He has to be able to do it for you. For example, somebody is dead. And I go to their grave and I say to them, give me, this is what? This is shirk akbar. It falls under the one that's shirk akbar. Ghayru jaiz. It's not permissible. Inshallah, we'll bring evidence and everything for it, don't worry. It's what? It's shirk. The Quran referred to this as what? Because Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He tells us, لا يسمعوا دعاءهم. These dead that you're calling to, they can't hear your dua. وَلَوْ سَمِعُوا مَسْتَجَابُوا لَكُمْ وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يَكْفُرُونَ بِشِرْكِكُمْ وَلَا يُنَبِّئُكَ مِثْلُ خَبِيرٌ. They can't hear your supplication. They're dead. Gone. They can't hear you. In the Sharia, the dead can't hear. And they can't. And they can't help you. وَلَوْ سَمِعُوا مَسْتَجَابُوا لَكُمْ. Even if they do hear, they can't. وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يَكْفُرُونَ بِشِرْكِكُمْ وَلَا يُنَبِّئُكَ مِثْلُ خَبِيرٌ. Hay has to be alive. Are you with me, brothers? I'm not going off topic. I don't want to go too details. Do the dead hear? What's the issue of it? What about the hadith of Umar radiallahu anhu? Are you there? Of Bi'ru Qulayba, when the Prophet went to the Battle of Badr, and he said to the people of the... That's it, niqash, we can have another time. It's another issue. This is a muqaddimah, introduction. Are you there? There's a book I would tell students to go to. It's called Al-Ayatul Bayinat. في عدم استماع الأموات عند الحنيفية السادات written by محمد أمير الصنعاني شيخ الألباني رحمه الله he has a تعليقات and a footnote on it. Go to that book and read it inshallah ta'ala, and the book written by محمد أمير الصنعاني. Are you there, brothers? So the dead, you can't ask. حاضر, the person has to be with you. You're not allowed to ask anybody who's not with you. I'm down here right now in London. I'm not communicating with anybody. I'm not calling anybody. Right now here, I ask a brother, can you get me this cup of water? And he's not with me. This is what? Shirk Akbar. The reason why these are shirk, by the way, why are they shirk? What's the reason? The reason, pay attention, please, stop writing, inshallah, stop writing. The Hayy, I said, is what? Is one who's alive, right? Why is it that if you ask him, it becomes shirk akbar? It's because you believe he has tasarruf kawni. You believe he runs this universe. You're giving him ability that's not his. You're saying he has tasarrufat. He can do things. Hadir is like you're saying he's hearing it all. And that's only Allah's ability, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who can hear everything. If he's not with you, how does he hear this statement of yours? Allah is the one who hears everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّتِي تُجَادِلُكَ فِي زَوْجِهَا. Allah hears it. It's his ability. You've given that attribute to the creation. Last but not least, which summarizes it all, is that he's able to do it. He's alive. He's with you, but you ask him for some things he can't do. You say, brother, I want children. Brother, can you send rain for us? This is what? Shirk Akbar. This is what? It's called what? It is called Shirk Akbar. The one that's غَيْرُ جَائِز is the opposite of that, right? Which is what? If he's not alive, if he's not present with you, or if he's not able to do so. It's the opposite of that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said in the Quran, talking to us, diverting this ibadah for anybody, for other than Allah. Allah clearly states this in the Quran. So let's look at verses. Allah says, وَلَا تَدْعُ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَنْفَعُكَ وَلَا يَضُرُّكَ فَإِنْ فَعَلْتَ فَإِنَّكَ إِذَا مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. Allah says, He commands us, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, وَلَا تَدْعُ Do not supplicate, do not ask of مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ besides Allah مَا لَا يَنْفَعُكَ وَلَا يَضُرُّكَ فَإِنْ فَعَلْتَ But if you choose to do that, فَإِنَّكَ إِذَا مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ You are from the ظَالِمِينَ. This ظَالِمِينَ here is, because sometimes ظُلْم comes as minor and sometimes it comes as major. This one is means by the disbelievers. It's the same one as الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ It's that same ظُلْم. It means disbelief. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, وَمَنْ يَدْعُ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ Anybody who calls on to, وَمَنْ يَدْعُ Anybody who calls on to, مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَٰهًا آخَرَ لَا بُرْحَانَ لَهُ بِهِ فَإِنَّمَا حِسَابُهُ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِ إِنَّهُ لَا يُفْلِحُ الْكَافِرُونَ Allah says, anybody who calls on to, who supplicates with Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he asks with Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, that which he has no evidence for. He always allowed you to do this. What's going to happen to you? فَإِنَّمَا حِسَابُ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِ Your punishment is with your Lord, Allah. إِنَّهُ لَا يُفْلِحُ الْكَافِرُونَ The disbelievers are never going to find prosperity. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells us in another ayah, وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ مِمَّنْ يَدْعُو مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ مَنْ لَا يَسْتَجِيبُ لَهُ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ وَهُمْ عَنْ دُعَائِهِمْ غَافِلُونَ Then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala He says, وَإِذَا حُشِرَ النَّاسُ كَانُوا لَهُمْ أَعْدَاءً وَكَانُوا بِعِبَادَتِهِمْ كَافِرِينَ So these are all verses that are clear to show that you can't supplicate to anybody other than Allah. Because Allah is saying here, وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ Who is more misguided? وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ مِمَّنْ يَدْعُو مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ مَنْ لَا يَسْتَجِيبُ لَهُ The one who can't hear him. مَنْ لَا يَسْتَجِيبُ لَهُ The one that cannot hear him. إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ وَهُمْ And those, وَهُمْ عَنْ دُعَائِهِمْ غَافِلُونَ And they're heedless of your supplication. وَإِذَا حُشِرَ النَّاسُ كَانُوا لَهُمْ أَعْدَاءً And those you are asking, if you get resurrected with them the day of judgment, they are going to disbelieve in you. They're going to be like, no, I've got nothing to do with you. Why were you asking me for? Bruv, leave me alone. That's what they will say to you the day of judgment. So you're not allowed to divert it for anybody other than Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Allah also says to us, وَيَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ They worship besides Allah. مَا لَا يَضُرُّهُمْ وَلَا يَنْفَعُهُمْ They worship that which will not benefit them nor harm them. Allah also says subhanahu wa ta'ala قُلْ أَتُنَبِّئُونَ اللَّهَ بِمَا لَا يَعْلَمُ فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَلَا فِي الْأَرْضِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ Now some people will come up to you today and they will say to you, you know what, listen here. I actually do not believe the man in the grave that I'm asking, I don't believe he has any tasarrufat. I don't believe he runs anything. No, I don't. You know why I'm asking him? It's because I'm a sinner. I'm a wrongdoer. I'm a criminal. I've gone against Allah's commands. I've disobeyed Him many times. I can't go to Allah directly. No, not at all. Just like a secretary has to get you through to the president. You can't just run into the president's office. It's disrespectful. So Allah is the same. Can't go to Him directly. We'll say that maqala, that statement of yours, wallahi is binassiha. It's that word for word. It's that which the disbeliever says. What did they say? مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى We are not worshipping these. We're not worshipping them. Only except for one reason. إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى So they can get us closer to Allah. They can get us closer to Allah. Their response was what? We are not worshipping the idols and whatever we're worshipping. The trees, the sun, the moon. So those who were worshipping the angels. Some of them worshipped the angels. They said that we were only worshipping whatever we're worshipping. For what reason? لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى So they can get us what? Closer to Allah. So this maqala, this statement, is the maqala and the statement of the تَشَابَهَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ قَدْ بَيَّنَّا لَكُمُ الْآيَاتِ The statements have now become similar to the statement of what? The disbelievers. So one should be very scared and cautious. Now somebody will come up to you and say, Akhi, are you right? Why? What was the problem with me? The problem is Allah permitted for us to do istighatha. Now istighatha, what's the difference? Istighatha just means requesting, asking, but in the times of hardship. It's just asking and requesting, but it's the times of hardship. Does that make sense? It's just qurubat, when you're going through distress and problems. They'll say to you, Allah said in the Quran about Nabiullah Musa alayhi salam, what did he do? ودخل المدينة على حين غفلة من أهلها فوجد فيها رجلين يختتلان قال هذا من شيعتي وهذا من عدوي فاستغاثه الذي من شيعتي على الذي من عدوي فوكزه موسى فقضى عليه So Nabi like Musa here, what does he do? Musa alayhi salam helps one man from over the other man. Does that make sense? So they say, فَاسْتَغَاثَ is what's being used in this verse. The man asked Musa alayhi salatu wasalam for help. And Musa was out there and he helped him. So istighatha is permissible. We'll say you use this example for something which you're not doing. Musa was what? Hay, hadir. And he asked him for bima yaqdiru alayhi, that which he was able to do. And that proves our point. That's the kind of istighatha and that's the kind of dua mas'ala that's permissible. That the person you're calling to has to be alive, he has to be there, and he has to be what? Able to do it. When you look at the Quran, you won't find anything other than that. Never will you find in the Quran nor the Sunnah where istighatha or dua is being done to somebody who is not hayyun hadirun bima yaqdiru alayhi. You will never find that. And if anybody does, please bring it forward to us. Anytime istighatha or dua or it's been used in a context where the person was present and he was. So let's stick to the Quran. And guess what? The Quran referred to anything other than hayyun hadirun bima yaqdiru ash-shirk. Did he not? He did. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he referred to it as shirk. I just mentioned the ayah before. وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ مِمَّا يَدْعُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ مَنْ لَا يَسْتَجِيبُ لَهُ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ وَهُمْ عَنْ دُعَائِهِمْ غَافِلُونَ وَإِذَا حُشِرَ النَّاسُ كَانُوا لَهُمْ أَعْدَاءً وَكَانُوا بِعِبَادَتِهِمْ كَافِرِينَ. So we mentioned that. Very good. That's crystal clear. And the next one is غَيْرُ جَائِزٍ, which is the opposite to that which I mentioned. So we now have the amthila. Don't we have the example? Now, also what falls under this, that I just wanted to mention as a very important point, even though that falls under dua ibadah, and I mentioned it in there already, which is the issue of slaughtering. You see, some people, they slaughter for other than Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Now, I want you to research this issue in a place where you can find it, inshallah ta'ala, which is the issue of, a guest is coming over to me. Are you there? A guest is coming over to me, and I slaughter for them to give them food. Is that shirk? Is that shirk? Huh? Is that shirk? A guest comes to my house and I make food for them. And the reason why I cut this, I slice this, I slaughter this animal is for my guest. Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen in Sharh Thalathat al-Usul, Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen in the Sharh of Thalathat al-Usul, he speaks about it there. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a. But the difference is, this you're doing it for the guest is not taqarruban. You're not getting closer and you're not expecting a naf'un ghaybiyun from them. You're not expecting an unseen benefit from them. Crystal clear? The one you're getting closer to is who? Taqarruban ila Allah. You're getting closer to Allah. You're doing it for this person for what? To get closer to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. But if you slaughter taqarruban, you know, you do it taqarruban, huh? And you're expecting naf'un ghaybiyun from this person, then it becomes what? Shirk akbar. This is important. Because Allah clearly says in the Quran, فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ. Pray to your Lord and slaughter for Him. And also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي my slaughtering وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ All of that is for Allah. لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ I don't associate partners with Him. It's important that you read the Quran. The Quran is crystal clear on these issues. Crystal clear. We're now going to move on to the third point, which is, what causes it? Asbab. What are the fundamental causes of Shirk Akbar? Why does it occur and how does it come into place? It's very important that we take this on board. Because knowing the reasons that cause it is what allows you to stay away from it. The first of it is what? And it was the first reason why it was done. And it's still the common reason why people do it today. And it is al-ghuluw fi salihin. Al-ghuluw fi salihin. It is going extreme on the righteous people. The person, he goes overboard with the righteous people. And that was the first reason why shirk took place on this earth. وَقَالُوا لَا تَذَرُنَّ آلِهَتَكُمْ وَلَا تَذَرُنَّ وَدًّا وَلَا سُوَاعًا وَلَا يَغُوثَ وَيَعُوقَ وَنَصْرًا. Why would these five righteous men, as Abdullah ibn Abbas mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari, these five men were righteous men. The people went extreme on them. Overboard with them. Are you with me? So it is al-ghuluw fil afadil. Go extreme on the righteous people and the ولذلك عبد الرحمن يحيى المعلمي إن كتاب التنكيل بما فيه تأنيب الكوثري من الأباطيل. عبد الرحمن يحيى المعلمي, he's a great noble scholar from Yemen who used to resided in Mecca, and he used to stay in مكتبتي الحرم. He used to stay there, and ما شاء الله, he has works that are profound and fun, especially this issue of عبادة العبودية. There's a كتاب he wrote, رفع الاشتباه, عن معنى العبادة والإله. He speaks about the تحقيق and the reality of what إله and عبادة means. والله طالب علم should read this book. والله that نفس, amazing book. He also has another book written on حقيقة البدعة, what بدعة means. And he also has refutation on who? محمد زاهد الكوثري الهالك. He has a refutation on him. Kawthari went and he done a takhrij and spoke about a book written by Khatib al-Baghdadi. And, you know, he went extreme on Abu Hanifa. And because of Abu Hanifa, love for Abu Hanifa, passion for Abu Hanifa, no doubt Imam Abu Hanifa is Imam. Imam. No doubt about that. Okay? And no one's putting his level down. لا شك ولا ريب. Does that make sense? But Muhammad Zahid al-Kawthari's love for Abu Hanifa, as he says, what did it do to him? It made him insult Anas ibn Malik and Malik ibn Anas, Shafi'i, and 300. Not one, not two, not three. 300 Salihin, A'immatu Salaf, Ashabu Rasulillah. He destroyed them and insulted them and belittled them just so he can protect Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'a. And if Abu Hanifa was alive, he would never accept that from him. Because that's not the tariqah of Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'a. May Allah bestow his never-ending mercy onto him. Now, pay attention here. Al-Imam Abdul Rahman al-Mu'allimi came years later, and he refuted Muhammad Zahid al-Kawthari on this book of his. Okay, he refuted him. And when he refuted him, Abdul Rahman al-Mu'allimi, he says, وَإِنَّ مِنْ أَوْسَعِ الْأَوْدِيَةِ الْبَاطِلَةِ. And he's mentioning this point, which is al-ghuluf al-afadil. Going extreme on the righteous people. He said, from one of the greatest valleys that people become destroyed and problems come is al-ghulu fil afadil. Going extreme on the righteous people. Are you there, brothers? I beg you all, inshallah ta'ala. And I've read it on you before, right? I have. Go to the kitab As-Sarimul Munki fil Raddi al Subki by Ibn Abdul Hadi. Go to the book As-Sarimul Munki fil Raddi al Subki by Ibn Abdul Hadi. Please do this. Ibn Abdul Hadi, he talks about the issue of ta'reem and the reality of it. Sahih? I read that statement on you. Some people say, I'm honoring this person. I am respecting them. Sah? Because Allah said in the Quran, وَتُعَزِّرُوهُ وَتُوَقِّرُوهُ وَتُسَبِّحُوهُ بُكْرَةً وَأَصِيلًا وَتُوَقِّرُوهُ تَوْقِيرُ النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم. I'm honoring the messenger. I'm respecting the messenger. We will say, you've misunderstood the reality of respecting and honoring the Prophet. Honoring the Prophet does not involve taking him out of his position, giving him the rights of Allah. That's not to respecting the Prophet. Does that make sense? The Prophet didn't like that. He said, لَا تَطْرُونِ كَمَا أَطْرَتِ النَّصَارَ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَ. Don't go extreme on me as the Christians went overboard with what? Isa ibn Maryam. Don't go. Rather, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, what did he say in the Quran? Ya ahl al-kitab, la taghlu fi dinikum wa la taqulu ala Allah ghayra al-haq. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said, لقد كفر الذين قالوا إن الله ثالث ثلاثة وما من إله إلا إله واحد وإن لم ينتهوا عما يقولون ليمسن الذين كفروا منهم عذاب أليم. Allah. Ya ahl al-kitab, la taghlu fi dinikum. Don't go extreme on your religion. Don't go overboard on your religion. So Abdul Hadi rahimahullah in his kitab As-Sarim al-Munki fi al-Radd ala al-Subki, he talks about the issue of the haqiqah of al-ta'zim, honoring the Prophet, respecting the Prophet, giving the Prophet his rights, does not involve taking him out of and stripping him from ubudiyya, servitude, and taking him into the realm of uluhiyya. That's not respecting the Prophet. And that is not respecting the wali and the awliya of Allah. Their right is to place them where Allah placed them. What did Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha say? We were commanded and nunzila nasa manazilahum. We were commanded to place the people in their placed positions. Respecting a person means that you place them in their rightful position. You don't take them overboard and you don't take them below their rights. So you know the statement of Al-Busiri. وَإِنَّ مِنْ جُودِكَ الدُّنْيَا وَضَرَّتَهَا وَمِنْ عُلُومِكَ عِلْمَ اللَّوْحِ وَالْقَلَمِ. This is ghulu, extreme in the rights of the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam. And that's exactly, as I said, وقالوا لا تذرن آلهتكم ولا تذرن ودا ولا سواعا ولا يغوث ويعوق ونصرا. Those were people who are صالحين. As Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, أسماء رجال صالحين. That's what the names of righteous men من قوم نوح. When their people died, they worshipped them. Also Allah تبارك وتعالى, He tells us the second thing is ta'zim qubur. It is honoring the graves of the righteous people. Another issue, these two. The graves of the righteous people. The building and the construction of the graves. Ahkam bina'ul qubur. This needs to be this. And inshaAllah ta'ala, I promise inshaAllah ta'ala, I'm going to be idhnillah al-kareem, do a talk, a lecture on the issue of ahkamul qubur, matters pertaining to the grave, the construction and how they should be built. It's something we need to know. Because the issue of the grave is being taken as the issue of the grave has become a dari'ah, has become a path and a way ila wuku' fi shirk al-akbar. They use this grave as a what? By placing surraj and other things on it and then building it and constructing it. So inshallah ta'ala we will bi'idhnillahi al-kareem see. Because the Prophet ﷺ, 5 days before he died, what did he say? لَعَنَ اللَّهُ الْيَهُودَ وَالنَّصَارَىٰ اتَّخَذُوا قُبُورَ أَنْبِيَائِهِمْ مَسَاجِدٍ. May Allah's curse be upon the Christians and the Jews, they took the graves of their prophets' masjids. And the Prophet was scared, عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. Aisha said that they will do the same thing to his grave. So he was warning against it, عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. إِذَنْ الْغُلُو فِي الْأَفَاضِلِ أَمَا الْغُلُو فِي الصَّالِحِينَ. And تَعْظِيمُ قُبُورِ الصَّالِحِينَ was the early stages. Also from those things that enter there was what? The issue of التصاوير, pictures and stuff like that. Pictures making and drawing and whatnot. All of them was a dari'atu ila shirk al-akbar. Okay, we spoke about the asbab, right? Those two are not the only asbab. Okay, they are not the only asbab. There are many more. There are many more other asbab that cause the occurrence and the happening of shirk al-akbar. But those are the two most prominent. Now inshallah ta'ala we're going to move on to the fourth thing that we need to know about shirk al-akbar, which is ahkamuhu, its rulings. What is the ruling or the judgment, the ruling on the person, or what happens to the person who comes with shirk al-akbar basically? What is it that happens to him? Awwalan, number one, that person is in the hellfire forever. He's in the hellfire. بأن صاحبه مخلد في نار جهنم فلا يخرج منها أبدا. They're never going to come out. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said in the Quran, إن الذين كفروا من أهل الكتاب والمشركين في نار جهنم خالدين فيها أبدا. They stay in the hellfire forever. خالدين فيها. They're going to stay in the hellfire. أولئك هم شر البرية. So Allah تبارك وتعالى says إن الذين كفروا من أهل الكتاب والمشركين في نار جهنم أولئك هم شر البرية. They are the worst of people. The worst of people. Because the word شر, as we all know, it is what? على صيغة أفعل. صيغة أفعل. And the ألف is dropped. The Hamza was dropped for what? بكثرة التكرار صح؟ الاستعمال. Good. So they are the worst of people. And it's from the Ism al-Tafdil, right? Very good. The person is in the hellfire forever. And also the second thing is that صاحبه لا يدخل الجنة. That the person will never enter Jannah whatsoever. And he's in the hellfire forever. Are you with me, brothers? And remember when Nabiullah Isa ibn Maryam said to his people, what did he say? إِنَّهُمَا يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلِيهِ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارِ وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنصَارِ. إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ. If you associate partners with Allah, فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلِيهِ الْجَنَّةِ. Allah has made Jannah haram from you. وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارِ. And the hellfire is your final abode. وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنصَارِ. And there's no one to help you. There's nobody able to help you. Wallahi, that's very scary. Do you love the ummah? Are you very concerned about the people? Protect them from this punishment. If you have family members you know are practicing things which are shirk akbar, save them. Save them from it. Because Allah tabarak wa ta'ala clearly tells us that they're in the hellfire forever. Number three, صاحبه لا يغفر له. The person is not, he's never forgiven. He's never forgiven. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he forgives whoever he wishes after that. وَمَن يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ افْتَرَى إِثْمًا عَظِيمًا. Number four. All of his actions, يُحْبِطُ جَمِيعَ حَسَنَاتِ صَاحِبِهِ. Every action that you have come with, all of them will be nullified, but إِن مَاتَ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ غَيْرِ تَوْبَةٍ. That is, if you die without repenting, all of your righteous deeds, your zakat, your hajj, your fasting, every single thing you've done, all nullified. Null and void. Unless you repent from it. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, لَوْ أَشْرَكُوا وَلَوْ أَشْرَكُوا لَحَبِطَ عَنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. If they associate partners with Allah, everything which they have done, it will be nullified. لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ. Allah spoke to the Prophet. لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَا تَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ بَلِ اللَّهَ فَاعْبُدْ وَكُن مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ. So the person who associates partners with Allah, لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ. All of your righteous deeds are going to be null and void. Allah is going to nullify it, all of it. Based on that, my beloved brothers and sisters, I wanted to say to all of you, فَإِنِّي أُحَذِّرُكُمْ, I warn you all, مِنَ الشِّرْكِ الْأَكْبَرِ, from the shirk al-akbar. Stay away from it. Stay away from it. لِأَنَّ عَوَاقِبَهُ وَخِيمًا. Wallahi, because its consequences are very severe. وَلَا يُمْكِنُ لِأَحَدٍ, and no one is able to stay away from it unless what? إِلَّا بَعْدَ مَعْرِفَتِي, unless you know it. You will not be able to stay away from this unless you understand what shirk al-akbar is. Unless you understand the real meaning of tawheed, to stay away from something, عرفت الشر لا للشر ولكن لتوقي ومن لم يعرف الشر من الخير يقع فيه. Do you want to protect yourself from an evil? Learn evil. Not do it, but learn it, understand it. Okay? Shirk is an evil. Learn this evil so you can stay away from it. ولذلك, this statement came from who? None other than the noble companion, حذيفة بن اليمان. كان الناس يسألون رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الخير. وكنت أسأله عن الشر مخافة أن يدركني. I used to ask about the evil. The people go, they used to went to the Prophet and they would ask him for good. I would go and I would ask him about the evil so I could stay away from it. Or so I didn't fall into it. So my beloved brothers and sisters, stay away from shirk al-akbar. And you will not be able to stay away from it unless you not, unless you what? Unless you understand it. Brothers, ما لا يتم الواجب إلا به فهو wajib. For you, if something cannot be done, an obligatory act cannot be done, unless you do something else, then that something else becomes obligatory for you to do. Does that make sense? Wudu is not obligatory. Do I have to do wudu right now? No. I've got the choice if I want to. But if the salah comes in, does it become obligatory? And I don't have wudu, do I have to do wudu now? Yes. Why? Because of the salah is obligatory. And you can't do the salah unless you are upon a state of tahara, so it becomes obligatory now on you. For you to stay away from shirk and to come with tawheed, is it obligatory? Yes. Can you stay away from tawheed? Can you stay away from shirk and come with a tawheed unless you know it? You can't, unless you know it, right? You have to know it. And then knowing it, it is what? It's fardu ayn on everybody. Every single body has to know tawheed and understand it, and every single body needs to know shirk in order to stay away from it. We've now concluded and we finished, inshaAllah ta'ala, the first part, which is shirk al-akbar. We have an understanding of it now. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Praises to Allah alone. We're now going to move on to shirk al-asghar. We're going to now move on to shirk al-asghar. My beloved brothers and sisters, we've now finished, alhamdulillah, praises to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. We spoke about shirk al-akbar. We defined it. We gave an example for it. We even mentioned the things that cause it for it to happen. And we also gave the consequences for the individual who comes with shirk al-akbar. May Allah protect us from it. Allahumma ya Rabb. Oh Allah, protect us from it. And protect our loved ones from it. الشرك الأصغر, now we're going to move on to. شرك الأصغر. We're going to define it. We're going to give an example for it. And we're also going to mention the rulings of the one and the consequences of the one who comes with it. The reason why we're not going to mention the reason is because it's the same. The asbab is both the same. They both have the same root causes for it. Okay? The root causes are what? The same. But these are the three that are different. So inshallah ta'ala we'll mention those three. The first inshallah ta'ala is ta'rifuhu, what's the definition? So what's the definition of shirkul asghar? The definition of a shirkul asghar is whatever, right, and I want you to understand this, whatever these two things are present in it is shirkul asghar akbar. So, shirkul asghar, two things has to be found in it in order for it to be shirkul asghar. For it to be shirkul asghar, and the definition of it is, the first one is ما سماه الشارع شركا. The first one is ما سماه الشارع ما سماه ما سماه الشارع شركا. Whatever the Sharia refers to as shirk, or معناه, or anything like it, like kufr, or anything like that. That's it, no. And also, because if we stop there, then it could also be what? Akbar. Because the Sharia refers to the major one as shirk, right? It can't just be that. The Sharia has to refer to it as a what? But it also has to be what? An yakuna wasila ila ashirk. أن يكون وسيلة إلى الشرك الأكبر. Pay attention here now. These are the two things that it has to be. The first one is ما سماه الشارع شركا أو معنى. The Sharia has to refer to it as shirk. Such as من حلف بغير الله فقد أشرك. Anybody who swears by anybody other than Allah is what? فَقَدْ أَشَرَكَ. That person has what? He has done shirk. Right? But we also know that الْحِلْف بِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ is a what? Is a wasila إِلَى الشِّرْكِ الْأَكْبَرِ. It's a means to a shirk al-akbar. Does that make sense? It's a wasila. Are you there? Also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, man ta'allaqa tamima, faqad ashraka. The Prophet told him he done shirk. The person who ta'allaqa tamimatan, who connects a tamima to himself. Are you with me? A tamima. Are you with me, brothers? This is what? Shirk al-asghar. Why? An yakuna wasilat ila shirk al-akbar. It's a means to shirk al-akbar. It's a what? نعم. So that's the definition of it. As for example, I think I gave it to you right now, صح? I gave you الحلف بغير الله, and I gave you the issue of تميمة. And I did speak about the issue of تعويز, as they call it, and the issue of تميمة. Is that تميمة is not a سبب شرعي. Am I sick? For example, I'm a I'm a sick patient. Pay attention here. I'm a sick patient. I'm sick. And what do I need? What do I need? I need for health and cure, right? The way I can cure myself is either through a what? A sabab which is shar'i, a legislation or Islamic means, such as Quran and adhkar and whatnot, and things that the sharia has prescribed, such as honey and whatnot. This is a what? It's a cure based on what? The Quran and the Sunnah. Good. The second step I can take to cure myself is a what? A means which is qadari. Medically, it's been proven. Doctors have come to the conclusion that this is a cure. Does that make sense? Pay attention. Those two is the only ways I can cure myself. I can't cure myself if it's not shar'i, nor is it a rope being tied to my arm. How is that shar'i? Because the sharia actually considered that to be shirk. And then how is it qadari? Pay attention. That this is going to make you... This is shirk. And it's shirk asghar. But it becomes shirk asghar. Sorry, it became shirk asghar because of the sharia referring to it as shirk or ma'ana. And and this is leading to what? Shirk akbar. It leads what? To shirk akbar. Because the person who's wearing it believes what? He believes that this is a means that is going to cure him, remove an evil eye from him, and etc. This is shirk asghar. But what about if he actually believes? You know what? The cure in and within itself is in what? He actually says, you know what? Nah. It becomes what? Even the medication that you take, the paracetamol that you take, that if you say what? That this is the cure in and within itself, this is shirk akbar. This is a shirk akbar. That's not now shirk asghar that we're talking about. It became shirk akbar. Does that make sense? Very good. Now we're going to mention the last point, ahkamuhu, its rulings. The hukum for it. Inshallah ta'ala, the scholars differed upon this particular point that I'm going to mention, which is ahkamu. And that is the person going to be in the hellfire forever? The reason why they differed upon this is because, pay attention, the reason why they differed on this one is because the ayat just mentioned shirk. إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارُ وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنصَارِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ وَالْمُشْرِكِينَ فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمَ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمْ شَرُّ الْبَرِيَّةِ. So all of these ayat are just mentioning shirk unrestrictedly. So since it's unrestricted, it's referring to what? Shirk al-Akbar and shirk al-Asghar as well. So both of them are the same when it comes to the Day of Judgment. That the person will stay in the hellfire ever. That's the opinion taken by who? Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah alayhi rahmatullah. He took that opinion. Whereas the majority and the overwhelming scholars, they said no. The person will not stay in the hellfire forever. He would be in the hellfire for a period of time. And they didn't deal with it as though it's shirk al-akbar. Crystal clear? Very good. As for the forgiveness, it's the same. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءَ. نعم. Based on that, my beloved brothers and sisters, based on that, I want to now, inshallah ta'ala, tell you all that we have finished Nawaqidh Tawheed al-Uluhiyah. So we've, mashallah, managed to finish the what? The six articles of faith. Which one have we finished? Al-Imanu Billahi, believing in Allah. These six parts, we have actually finished Al-Imanu Billahi. If somebody asks you, what does it mean to believe in Allah? Those six parts, they cover it. That's it. Alhamdulillah. We study Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, al-Uluhiyyah, al-Asma'i wa Sifat. 2-3 minutes, inshallah ta'ala, I've got one last point to conclude with, and that is the relationship between all of those tawheeds. How are they related and how do they work together? So, alaqat, al-alaqa, bayn al-aqsam. the relationship between these types. How are they related? Between what? Tawheed al-uluhiyya, al-rububiyya, and al-asma'i, wa sifat. And it is as follows. Inshallah ta'ala, note this down. The relationship between the three is as follows. Every single one of the two, which is al-rububiyya, so we start with the first one, which is tawheed al-asma'i wa sifat. The first one we start with is what? Tawheed al-asma'i wa sifat. Al-rububiyya comes from what? Al-rabbu. Al-uluhiyya comes from what? Allah, right? Ama ilah. Allah. Both of them are what? They are names and attributes of Allah. Sahih? So, rububiyya is Rabb and uluhiyya is Allah, right? And they are both what? Asma'un min asma'illahi. They are names from the names of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Also, as the second one, which is tawheed al-rububiyya, right? Tawheed al-rububiyya فهو مستلزم لتوحيد الألوهية. توحيد الربوبية necessitates توحيد الألوهية. Which is what? If you single Allah in توحيد الربوبية completely, then you're contradicting yourself in not coming with توحيد الألوهية. If you're saying Allah is the only creator, Allah is the only sustainer, Allah is the only provider, then why don't you worship Him alone? It necessitates it. مستلزم لتوحيد مستلزم لتوحيد الألوهية. As for توحيد الألوهية فهو متضمن لتوحيد الربوبية. توحيد الألوهية, if you affirm it, you've by default come with توحيد الربوبية. If you have توحيد الألوهية, you have by default come with what? You have by default come with التوحيد الربوبية. Because every single person, فكل من عبد الله, everybody who worships Allah, لابد أن يكون قد أقر بربوبيته. Anybody who worships Allah alone has to have affirmed that Allah is the only creator, the only sustainer, the only provider. That's the relationship between each and every one of them. That is the علاقة بين أقسام الثلاثة, the three types of توحيد that we mentioned. So there is what? Talazum. They necessitate one another. So it is obligatory on every single person to come with what? بتوحيد الربوبية وتوحيد الألوهية وتوحيد الأسماء والصفات. According to how we explained it, any mistakes and any shortcomings that I came with whilst I was speaking, then know that it is from me and Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are totally free from it. سبحانك اللهم بحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.